show you a chart. It was a chart in logarithm where we have shown how energy had a change in the last 5 years in the U.S. And I mentioned that the good news was that the renewables have grown almost by a factor of two over the last 5 years. But the realization from that chart was the fact that the only technology that can be scaled up to replace fossil fuels is going to be nuclear energy, okay? And obviously we can talk about the politics of that, we can talk about the environmental impact of that, but that's the reality. And in the U.S., for a number of years, there was a program, and people were talking about the nuclear renaissance. Back in the 70s, in 1979, there was a big accident in the U.S. There was a nuclear power plant in the state of Pennsylvania, a place called Three Mile Island. And some of you have heard about that. It was almost a near meltdown in the reactor. And as a result of that accident, that was the last time that we had built the nuclear power plant in the U.S. And as I had mentioned, most of the expected life for those reactors were 40 years. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission started a program called the Life Extension Program to expand the life of reactors from 40 to 60 years. Those of you who are involved in fracture mechanics will appreciate the fact that one of the most important aspects of the Life Extension Program was to show that the materials used in the various reactor components had to show certain values of fracture toughness. And what happens when you irradiate materials, in particular metallic structures, to nuclear irradiation, the fracture toughness goes down as a function of time. Materials become more brittle. And obviously that was a major concern, that if you had a crack in the pressure vessel in the reactor, that reactor will not fail. So that was the focus of that life extension program, to make sure that reactors will operate for another 20 years in a reliable way. And then Fukushima happened, and this was a major blow to the nuclear renaissance. These are relatively old reactors, what we call generation 2, generation 3 light water reactors. The problem here, obviously, was connected to the tsunami. Even though those power plants have been designed, assuming that you will have a major incident of tsunami, the intensity, the magnitude of the tsunami was such that there was very little that could have been done. And it was really a shame. Some of the explosions that happened were as a result of the generation of hydrogen. In a typical reactor, you have the fuel inside the fuel cladding elements, which are made out of zirconium. And when you lose cooling in the reactor, you can generate a lot of hydrogen. And that hydrogen is what really produced the explosion that you saw in the reactor. So that was a major setback. And then the other setback, again, it was the fact that from the economics, the availability of relatively inexpensive natural gas in the U.S. have changed the equation. In fact, there is a recent report where they talk about the implications of having inexpensive gas on climate change. And obviously, the availability of natural gas in the U.S. has really changed the equation. By having lower prices of natural gas, you can start replacing nuclear. You can replace coal, which is good news. But then you can also replace renewables. As long as you don't have a carbon tax, even clean natural gas produces CO2. And then the big question is, what's going to happen to climate change? Again, natural gas is cleaner than coal, but nonetheless, it used to generate CO2. And this study does a good job looking at the impact of natural gas, in particular to kill nuclear energy. So this is a major problem. I have a slide here on the fuel cycle. I don't know what happened, but you know, your colleague had brought up the issue of spent nuclear fuel, and that's one of the that's one of the big challenges. What do we do with spent fuel? Back in the 1970s, there was a president in the U.S. His name was Jimmy Carter, and Jimmy Carter was a nuclear engineer. I don't know if you knew about it. He actually served in the Navy. He was an officer in a nuclear power submarine. Jimmy Carter, and he became a president. And what's interesting about this is that the U.S. was debating what to do with the spent nuclear fuel. And there was a program where you could reprocess the fuel. Because when you look at fuel, there's still a lot of energy that is stored in the spent fuel, and that could be reprocessed. And there was a program to reprocess fuel. The problem is that as a result of that, you could produce plutonium. And there was a lot of concern with something called nuclear proliferation. There were many countries that were very interested in having access to nuclear weapons. And because of that, President Carter decided to stop those programs to reprocess nuclear fuel. If we had continued with those programs, we could have reused the fuel and make a better utilization of that. I apologize, the slide here disappeared, but the idea is that with reprocessing, you can reduce the amount of spent fuel that has to go to a repository like Yokohama. The French have a program called the Brigger Reactor, where you can actually make better utilization of fuel. So this is one of the big challenges, the fuel cycle, and what do we do with spent nuclear fuel. And when we talk about nuclear fuel, it's not just fission, but it's also fusion. This is there are big expectations with this type of reactors. This is a schematic of the plant that is being built in Cavarache, where the availability of relatively clean electricity is a real promise. The problem with a fusion is that there are some significant engineering challenges. I remember when I was in school 30 years ago, people said, "Oh, fusion is 10 years into the future," and then I finished school and fusion was 10 years into the future. And today, fusion is 10 years into the future, so I hope we'll see a fusion. There are different concepts. This is probably the most likely concept for a power plant. There's also another approach where you can use lasers to initiate the self-sustaining nuclear reaction. But I think the tokamak-based approach is going to be the most likely. From a materials perspective, there are significant challenges. The plasma-facing materials are subjected to pretty extreme conditions of temperature, nuclear radiation, durability. And then behind this system, you have heat exchangers where you can take some of the heat, produce steam, and then move a turbine. But so big hopes in this ITER concept. Now let's talk about fossil energy, and the reason why we talk about fossil energy is that if you remember that chart where we showed the energy used in the last 5 years, the realization is that we are not going to replace fossil fuels in the next 50 years. Okay, that's a fact. I wish I could tell you otherwise, but that's not going to happen. We're going to have to rely on fossil fuels for the next 50 years. So the point is there something that we could do to improve on the efficiency? Because if you could improve the efficiency in the way these plants operate, then you could reduce the amount of emissions. And hopefully in the next 20 years, after we get a bridge technology, we may be able to minimize the impact. So the realization is that we're going to have to rely on coal. Thermodynamics always gives us the answer for this. This is a phase diagram for water. Here you have pressure, here you have temperature, you have here the triple point of water, and here you have something called the critical point. There is a concept called ultra-supercritical steam boilers, ultra-supercritical, which means that you're going to be working at very high temperatures, very high pressures. And when you operate in this ultra-supercritical regime, what's going to happen is that the efficiency of the power plant is going to increase. So by improving on the efficiency of the power plant, the amount of emissions that you're going to generate for a given unit of energy is going to decrease. So we are building a system of plants called ultra-supercritical steam boilers. They're going to be working at 760 degrees C, very high temperature, very high pressure. Whenever you subject materials to these pressures, the temperatures creep, or the resistance to time-dependent deformation is a big issue. And that's an area where we are working. Another thing that can be done is utilize these combined cycle plants, where you start with natural gas, you could drive a turbine, and then by using heat recovery systems, you could drive a steam turbine. And by combining a gas turbine with a steam turbine, you can get up to 60-65% efficiency, which is actually very good. It's not perfect, you still generate CO2, but this is a way in which you could improve the efficiency of these power plants. In the case of the ultra-supercritical steam boilers, you have miles and miles of tubing. You have water running through those tubes in the form of steam. As I mentioned, these are very high pressures, very high temperatures. And then you can no longer use iron-based alloys to make these tubes. You have to rely on super alloys. And we know how to do the metallurgy with nickel-based super alloys. The problem is that these alloys are very expensive. Nickel is very expensive, but we ideally would like to use iron-based super steels, for example. But we haven't been able to do it. And what's interesting is that, you know, for many years people thought that all the science and technology of steel had been set. But it's amazing that we still are developing new steel iron-based alloys that have the corrosion resistance and the creep resistance that can compete, at least in the 600 degrees C range, with nickel-based super alloys. For higher temperatures, again, 700 degrees C, we're going to have to rely on this type of alloys. This is an example of a nickel-based super alloy called Haynes 230, which is mainly nickel. And again, it works really well, but it's much more expensive. So we go back to this issue of cost. You know, it's not just the efficiency, it's not just the technology, but it's also cost, because at the end of the day, there's going to be a consumer paying for electricity. And if they can pay a cent less, they'll be willing to do it, unless we start accounting for the cost of emission. You know, this is really going to boil down to that. Do we pay for emissions before or after the after fact? So it's an area where there's a lot of research. Super steels, iron-based alloys with good creep resistance, good corrosion resistance, and good durability. The other issues with steam turbines, and obviously the pressures and the temperatures are going to be higher. Same issues you have here, rotating the machinery that's moving at 3600 RPM, where now you have issues related to fatigue. There's a lot of work trying to develop alloys that can operate in these turbines in an efficient way. So we mentioned that natural gas is good news, but nonetheless we still produce CO2. And the question is, what do we do with CO2? Okay? We mentioned something called carbon capture and sequestration. Okay? And obviously that's going to add a cost to the production of electricity, but at least we can remove CO2 from the environment. So this is a schematic that shows various things that we could do with CO2. The first one, which had been studied and is now dead, was the idea of capturing CO2 from the power plant. And literally, you could have piping taking all the exhaust from the power plant and then inject it into the bottom of the ocean. Okay? People said, oh, you know, the oceans are so big, we should be able to just put it into the ocean. And then somebody did a, it was actually a master's thesis at MIT, and they said, okay, let's do a calculation. If we start pumping all the CO2 that we produce in the U.S. into the bottom of the ocean, what's going to happen? And then what happens is that you start changing the pH in the water. That's going to alter the flora and fauna in the ocean, and it's going to be catastrophic. And this is just from the CO2 coming out of the U.S. So that idea was dead pretty quickly, and it was a master's degree. You know, it was a very nice thesis. It was a very influential work, and they showed that this is a bad idea. This is a bad idea. Another alternative is that you sequester the CO2, and then you can inject it into the bottom of the earth. There is a process called carbonation, where you can take inject CO2, and some minerals will absorb it, and hopefully it will be stable. There are some concerns, though. There was a village in Africa, and it was a small village. And this village was established next to a lake. And one day, everybody in the village had died. So they started doing an investigation, and what they found was that they had all been killed by CO2. And CO2 had actually bubbled from the lake. And the concentration of CO2 was so intense that pretty much everybody near the lake died. And the concern that injecting CO2 deep down is that what's going to happen if there is an earthquake or there is a crack and then CO2 comes up to the surface? You know, what's going to do that? So that's a pretty serious issue, that if you cannot fix the CO2 with some minerals, there's always going to be a possibility for the CO2 to come back and do damage. So that's something from a geological perspective, is something that needs to be taken into consideration. Another thing that is currently being used in many locations in the U.S., especially around Texas and Oklahoma, is to use CO2 to inject it into oil fields. And by pressurizing the oil field, you can pump more oil. In Mexico, in the Gulf of Mexico, there is a company called Pemex Petróleos Mexicanos, and there is a fairly large oil field called Cantarell, and that field has been drying. And what they are doing is they are injecting nitrogen to pump more oil out of the field. But this will do exactly the same. You can take CO2, inject it into the field, and then it will push oil out. And again, this has been used successfully. Obviously, you still have to do the balance of the CO2, and at the end of the day, it's going to be a negative balance. So this is always going to be an issue. So this is the main concern. You know, what do we do with CO2? And something that is actually very attractive, especially for the civil engineers, is the question of whether or not we could use CO2 to make construction materials. You know, where you could use some magnesium carbonate bricks that will depend on CO2. So instead of using typical cement that requires a lot of energy and produces a lot of CO2, you could use the CO2 to build construction materials. And there's actually a lot of research. If you review the literature, there's a lot of people looking at various lithium-based, magnesium-based compounds that can absorb CO2. And that could become a commodity. You could actually use the CO2 to build construction materials, especially in the area of ceramics. There are lots of patents. This is a case of Toshiba, where they have developed a technology that absorbs CO2 to make construction materials. So this is a good area. It's an important area. We talk about cement. This is a company from Great Britain. These were students from the Imperial College, where they showed that using what they call green cements, they can actually replace Portland cement with a very significant positive impact on CO2 emissions. So these are good news. You know, people, there's innovation, creativity, and there could be some good opportunities to capture and use CO2 in a positive way. In the US, there is a highway called Highway 35. This reaches Minneapolis from the south. And a few years ago, a bridge in that highway collapsed. And it was a catastrophic effect. Several people died, and it was a fatigue problem. They had found that some plates in that bridge were vibrating, crack propagating. There was no inspection of the bridge collapsed, people died. And then they rebuilt the bridge. The good news is that they use a lot of these green cement type of concepts to build the bridge. And these materials actually absorb CO2. And as they absorb CO2, they become stronger. So as cement cures and becomes stronger, the same thing happens with these cements. The only thing that they did is they add fly ash. Fly ash is a byproduct. Whenever you burn coal, they mix the fly ash with these green cements. And this is an example of how civil engineers have come to the rescue. And these are actual results. These are materials that, as long as they are there, they're going to be absorbing CO2. And that process is going to make the structure stronger. Okay? So CO2, it's a big problem. This is going to be the problem of our generation. What do we do with CO2? Especially for the next 50 years, because whether we like it or not, we're going to rely on fossil fuels.
So, I have been reading last days about carbon capture.
Yes.
And the thing is that the third option, like carbonate, carbonation, mm-hmm. is like by far the most expensive one. So, do you actually think that it's better than the geological storage?
Yeah, and you know, it's the first thing that we do is thermodynamics. So whenever you want to look at whether something can happen, the first thing you do is you do the thermodynamics calculus. So all these chemical reactions are governed by thermodynamics. So thermodynamics is going to tell you whether something is going to happen. So if you mix CO2 with this mineral, you're going to have this problem. And thermodynamics will tell you whether the free energy is negative, is going to happen, the free energy is positive, it's never going to happen. So thermodynamics is the first thing you do, is this possible, yes or no? The second thing that you look at is kinetics, because thermodynamics can tell you something can happen, but it will happen at such a slow speed that it may take 5 centuries to happen. So you do the kinetics, and kinetics will tell you, yeah, this can happen in 1 year or 100 years, and then you look at the cost equivalent of that. So all these decisions on whether you go into a geological repository, whether you take the CO2 stream and then use it for construction, is going to be really dictated by thermodynamics, kinetics, and then the cost of all that. In some cases, it may make sense to just go geological because the power plant is going to be close to a geological repository. In some cases, it may not make sense because you will have to have piping, you know, like 300 miles of piping to move CO2, that will be very expensive. So somebody may build a factory next to the power plant to use the factory there. So I think each case, especially the U.S. is such a big country, and whether you are on the Pacific Northwest or on the Southeast, the conditions will be different. And then the cost is going to depend really where you are. So I will say that it just depends whether you are geographically, whether it's the north or south, whether you have a geological formation where you can do it, whether you have a market to use the CO2 for some industry, and then you put all those things into consideration and decide this is actually going to be less expensive than these other options. Does that make sense? So, you know, it's just a combination. This is a multivariable problem, and then you have to take everything into consideration. Obviously, there are some good solutions, you know what I mean? Replacing cement with this type of, it really makes a lot of sense. But there's also a cost associated with it, and we just have to put that into the equation. So, is carbon capture and sequestration going to happen? And the answer is, it just depends. If we put a tax on carbon, it's actually going to happen. You know, people are really going to see the business opportunity and do it. If we don't put a tax on carbon, and it's actually cheaper just to dump it into the environment, it's going to happen. And this is why I show you this morning the political equation. You know, technologically, you know, we know thermodynamics, we know kinetics, we know mechanics of materials, chemistry, I mean, we really have all the fundamentals. But these were public policies and the politics of the problem that come into the picture and what's going to happen. So we hope there's going to be a carbon tax. That's going to make the cost of electricity more expensive, but at least it's going to give all these alternative sources of energy a chance to compete with that. More questions? Does that make sense? You know, in this morning, the reason why I want to share with you the discussion on politics is that it's part of reality. You know, we can sit down and we can write great equations and we can go to the lab and we can make green cement, but unless we put this in the context of people making decisions at the national level, the fact that everything is based on an economic element, nothing is going to happen. So it's really the big picture that we all have to be aware of. And also try to motivate you to become active. I mean, when you vote, you know, your vote says something, you know. I mean, if there is a political party that is actually based on obeying the laws of thermodynamics, you should vote for those people. A lot of times, you know, people believe that they can violate the laws of thermodynamics, and you as an engineer should know better than that, okay? So that was part of the message this morning, is really to make you aware of all those factors. Let's talk about transportation, because this is big. We all depend on transportation. And in the case of the U.S., a fourth of the energy goes to transportation. And if you do a thermodynamic analysis, you will see that for most internal combustion engines, only 30% of the energy contained in the fuel is actually used to move the vehicle. If you use diesel, you know, diesel engines are a little more efficient, you can probably get to 40%. We had a program in the U.S. called Super Truck, where they can show now you can get to 50% efficiency with diesel engines, which is actually remarkable, but it's very expensive. You really have to do a lot of things to get to 50% efficiency. So this is an example. If you take into account all the energy in the fuel, 30% goes out as heat, okay, and this energy is wasted. You have to pull the engine, that takes a quarter of the energy, and also you have friction and radiation. So again, only a third on average is used. So what can we do to improve efficiency in transportation? Well, The first thing you do is you reduce the weight of the structures. If you do that, that has the biggest impact on the on fuel efficiency. Now, most structures are made out of steel, and in the last 10 years, and this is remarkable because I remember when I was in grad school, everybody wanted to work on very fancy, you know, ceramics were really cutting edge, so everybody wanted to do a thesis on ceramics. And there were very few people who wanted to work on the steels. You know, people said, oh, steels, you know, that's last century's technology. I mean, nobody was excited about the steel. In the last 10 years, there have been more developments with the steel than we had in the last 50. And one of those developments is the so-called high-strength steels. If you look at the phase diagram for iron and carbon, you can find that there are some phases where you can intercalate carbon into the structure of a steel to make a steel. And you have different phases. You have martensite, you have austenite, and you can develop structures that are very strong, okay? That you can retain those structures at room temperature. And if you can have a stronger material, it means that you can reduce the thickness of the component. Because by having a stronger material, okay, you can afford to reduce the cross-sectional area of your component. And when you do that, if you start replacing these components with high strength steel, all of a sudden you are reducing 150, 200 pounds per oil year. And when you multiply 150, 200 pounds, that's a lot of oil. The other thing is that if you reduce the weight of the structure, then the engine can be smaller. And if the engine is smaller, then the chassis can be smaller. So you have this snowball effect that by using a stronger material, you can improve significantly the efficiency of one of it. So, big development, high strength steels. You have these materials called TRIP, transformation induced plasticity, is a mechanism by which you can have also high strength components. People have started using aluminum, which is a light weight alloy. The problem with aluminum is more expensive than steel, but you know, if you can afford to make the investment, you can also save a lot of weight. There are some components made out of magnesium. Magnesium is one of the lightest alloys available. The problem with magnesium is that its melting temperature is relatively low, which means that its creep resistance is also low. So you can only use magnesium in certain components that will not be subjected to high temperature. And probably the ultimate technology is going to be carbon fiber reinforced composites. So those of you working in composites will find that this is going to be the ultimate application for composites. If you look at your Formula One structures, they are all fiber reinforced composites. The reason why we haven't used them widely in automobiles is that they are still very expensive. And the challenge is the cost of carbon fiber. So we have programs in the lab where we are trying to reduce the cost of carbon fiber. So hopefully we'll be able to incorporate those materials into these structures. And again, the lighter the structure, the smaller the engine, the higher the fuel efficiency. I got this slide from General Motors a few years ago. And GM obviously is in the business of making cars. And this chart was probably prepared back in 2007, 2006, 2007. And this is a plot that shows in this direction you improve fuel efficiency and reduce emissions. So that was with a reduction in petroleum consumption, which was, remember, Gerald Ford, remember that speech from Gerald Ford? We gotta reduce our dependence on foreign oil. This was part of the strategy. So this chart shows you that as you move up, you improve fuel efficiency, you reduce petroleum consumption. And then on the horizontal axis, you have a time scale. So this is near term, mid term, and then long term. So if you ask GM back then, said, you know, what we expect to see in the near future is improvements in the internal combustion engine. You know, we'll make better lubricants, we'll make better pistons, we'll make better cylinders, and we'll be able to have engines where, you know, if you are standing on the light, waiting for the green light, instead of having four cylinders working, only one cylinder is going to be working, and then as you accelerate, then the other cylinders come up into action. So there are lots of technologies that you can implement that will give you improvements based on the internal combustion engine, okay? The problem is that these improvements are going to take you from 30% efficiency to 34% efficiency, 35% efficiency. But that's what GM saw in the near term. And then in the midterm, they saw the introduction of these hybrid electric vehicles. And they are so, there's one class called this plug-in hybrid, where you can plug them into the wall to charge the batteries, okay? And GM is selling a car in the US, it's called the Bolt. Have you heard about the Bolt? No? So the Bolt has a small gas engine. It's about 90 horsepower. It's very small. And it has a set of batteries. So the gas engine works as a generator. So as it's working, it charges the battery. And then the battery moves an electric motor. So the Bolt is really an electric car. If you work only with the batteries, you can drive about 40 miles, okay, and then the batteries die. But by having a small gas engine, you can always keep the batteries charged, okay? And this is what we call them hybrid, because they have a gas engine and they have an electric motor and batteries. That's what we call hybrids, electrical and still relying on the internal combustion engine. So these are currently being sold in the US. Toyota makes the Prius. Have you heard about the Prius? So the Prius has an electric motor, has an internal combustion engine, and has a system of batteries. And now Toyota sells this plug-in version where you can plug it into the wall. It takes about 6 to 8 hours to charge, and then you can use the electricity. Then farther long term, they saw these fully electric cars where there is no more gasoline engine, they just rely on the batteries. There's a company called Tesla. Okay, Tesla makes a full electric car. Nissan makes a car called the Leaf, which is 100% electric. And Mitsubishi is going to start selling a car. And again, these rely only on electricity. The problem is that the batteries will just give you a certain range. Okay, may give you 100 miles, 150 miles. And once you run out of charge, you have to recharge your batteries. And that usually takes 6 to 8 hours, so that's a real problem. Okay? So if you are commuting 20, 30 miles a day, that's no problem because you can charge overnight. You drive during the day, you come back home, you charge. If you want to drive across the country, that's a real problem because you may drive 100 miles and you gotta wait 6 hours to charge your batteries and another mile. So that's not very practical. But for cities, for city applications or short distances, this seems like a good solution. And then, really long term, GM believes that it's going to be all about fuel cells, where you can use hydrogen to operate a fuel cell. And the nice thing about a fuel cell is that if you use hydrogen and oxygen, what you produce is electricity and water. So it doesn't get any better than that. This is probably the cleanest, best technology. And the nice thing about fuel cells is that they can get up to 70% efficiency, which is just incredible. I mean, just think about it. 70% efficiency, there is no combustion, you put hydrogen, you put oxygen, and you get the electricity and water. Okay, so this is really perfect. The challenge there is how do you produce hydrogen in a way that doesn't rely on fossil fuels, and we're going to talk about this later this week on hydrogen production and hydrogen storage. So this is the view, and remember, this is 2007, this is before the big recession in the US. And if you ask GM, what's their vision for transportation? This still remains. If you ask Toyota, what's their vision for transportation? They still see fuel cell cars as the ultimate technology. And the reason why hydrogen is so attractive is because it takes so long to charge the batteries. You know, if you could charge the batteries in 10 minutes, this would be probably the ultimate solution for transportation. The reality is that physics tells you that you cannot charge batteries in such a short period of time. I mean, and we'll talk about here in a minute about batteries. But you can fuel your car with hydrogen in 10 minutes, 15 minutes. So if you want to go across country or across Europe drive, that's okay. You can drive 300 miles with a tank of hydrogen, and then in 15 minutes you can refuel in one of the 300 miles. So this is why, in terms of mobility and convenience, this is really going to be the ultimate technology. So we are not going to talk about fuel cells this week unless you have a specific interest. But in general, there are different types of fuel cells. This is the so-called PEM. PEM stands for polymer exchange membrane or proton exchange membrane. And in that membrane, this PEM is really at the core of the fuel cell. On one side, you have your cathode, and then on the cathode, what you use is air, oxygen from air. And then on the anode side, what you do is you fill your fuel, in this case, is going to be pure hydrogen. Now, the reason why we haven't seen more fuel cell automobiles is because they rely on catalysts, okay? And these catalysts are very expensive. One of the big challenges that we have in science today is trying to understand catalysis. And you know, catalysis works. To produce ammonia, you know, we use a catalytic process. There are lots of industrial processes that rely on catalysis, and we know that catalysis work. Probably here in Europe, every automobile has a catalytic converter. So any carbon monoxide that comes out of the engine has to go through the catalytic converter to become carbon dioxide. You can control NOx emissions with a catalytic converter also in your automobiles. So we know about catalysis. We know that catalysis works. But if you ask a chemist or a physicist what actually happens in catalysis, they are not going to tell you. If somebody explains to you what happens in catalysis, you're going to get the Nobel Prize. Write it up. The next big Nobel Prize is going to be whomever explains what happens in catalysis. So what are good catalytic materials? Platinum, palladium, okay, which are very expensive. And why are they so good? We don't know. The day we know why precious metals are so good catalytic materials, we're going to find a replacement. And that day, fuel cells are going to be very inexpensive. Okay? But we still have ways to go. What happens is, for example, when oxygen, you have your molecular oxygen, which is O2, touches the surface of a catalyst, something happens with the electrons. The oxygen goes from molecular oxygen to atomic oxygen, and then the oxygen takes some electrons. Okay? And that's really the magic behind all these fuel cells. The ability to disassociate molecular oxygen to atomic oxygen, give them some electrons, and when you close this circuit, the electrons that you are going to be giving to the oxygen are coming here from this cycle. This is what controls the closes the circuit and allows these electrons to go from one side to the other. On this side, you have hydrogen. You still have to rely on catalysis to go from molecular hydrogen to single protons. You take an electron out of the hydrogen, that electron goes into the circuit. Sorry. You know, this is funny because this was just a slide I was showing. That's weird. This is weird, I don't know, but...
perhaps if you grow a span of the fire.
Close it up?
Yes, perhaps.
This is a second way to get the Nobel Prize.
Understand, explaining what happened. Yeah, that's the second question. Yeah. You know, this used to happen a lot a few years ago with Max and pieces, but this was a. So we are talking about catalysis. You still have a catalytic process where you remove an electron out of the hydrogen. That electron goes back to the circuit, is given to the oxygen. Once you remove an electron out of hydrogen, you have a proton, and that proton can go across its membrane, okay? So the reason why we haven't adopted these systems is because of the cost of the catalyst. Platinum and palladium, very expensive. One day, hopefully, we'll be able to understand why they are so good, and we'll replace it. The other thing that happens is a little bit of heat here. When you do the thermodynamics calculations, you find that there's going to be some heat generated as a result of this process. Something that is very interesting about fuel cells is that there is a process called reforming. Okay, if you take methane and you combine it with water vapor, you can produce hydrogen. Okay, but you also produce CO2. So in principle, you could take natural gas and you will run natural gas through a reformer. You will produce hydrogen. That hydrogen can go into the fuel cell, but it also produces CO2. And then the CO2 will have to be sent to the atmosphere. Now, you will say, that doesn't make any sense. You know, why would you do that? Well, until we get an inexpensive way to generate hydrogen, we will probably have to rely on these so-called bridge technologies. Okay? The day we put a tax on carbon, then we will no longer use methane to produce hydrogen. We may rely on electrolysis, for example, or some other process that doesn't generate CO2. But the nice thing about these technologies is that you could use hydrofuels, you could also use methane or methanol or ethanol or some alcohol, and you could operate a fuel cell. Because all these organic compounds have hydrogen, and there is a way to disassociate the hydrogen from the molecule and then run it through your fuel cell. And then on this side, you only use oxygen, which is abundant in air. So this is why fuel cells are so attractive. And again, you know, we are talking about very high efficiencies, 55%. In the case of solid oxide fuel cells, solid oxide fuel cells work at much higher temperatures. You can get close to 65-70% efficiency, which is really remarkable. I mean, if you think about 70% efficiency from a solid oxide fuel cell. Now, there are many variations of solid oxide fuel cells. The ideal solid oxide fuel cell is going to be a big power plant where you take oxygen on one side, you take hydrogen on this side, and you produce electricity and also some water, okay? But before we get to that technology, people are using solid oxide fuel cell as auxiliary power units. Now, in the US, most products are transported by trucks, okay? So you may have green products from California, and they are sent by trucks on the highway to Florida and the East Coast, and that's a very long trip. And what happens is that the drivers of the truck, sometimes you have a team of two drivers, so someone can drive 8 hours and the other guy drives 8 hours, they can do that. But if you only have one driver in the truck, you have, by law, you have to stop and you have to rest. So you see, in the a few years ago, you used to see all these trucks on the side of the highway, and the engines would be running, especially at night. And the engine will be running to produce some heat to keep the temperature of the cabin comfortable. It will produce some electricity. In fact, I don't know if you have seen these trucks, but these trucks have microwave oven, TV, while they have computers. I mean, this is like a little mobile home. And but for them to operate the refrigerator, everything, they needed to have electricity. So what they did is they kept the engine running all the time. So they were burning diesel, okay, while the truck was standing, they couldn't drive because there's a limit on how many hours a driver can drive. And then the engine was producing all the electricity to keep the cabin operational. So somebody said, why don't we use a solid oxide fuel cell? The nice thing about the solid oxide fuel cell is that you could use diesel as a fuel. If you have a steam reformer, by combining a steam with diesel, you could produce hydrogen. The hydrogen goes into the fuel cell and it produces electricity. Now you still produce CO2, but because the efficiency is 60%, it's actually better than having the engine running on diesel. Okay? And then the fuel cell will produce all the electricity that you will need to provide electricity for the cabin. So this is called an auxiliary power unit. And all the trucks that you see in the US have an APU, the old trucks have the diesel engine, the newer trucks have these fuel cells that are very, very effective, you know, 60% efficiency. They also produce some heat, so that heat can be used for the air conditioning in the truck. I mean, this is a really neat technology. So this is an example of how, you know, it's not the big power plant that we are envisioning in the future, but that's a way to produce electricity and heat in a more efficient way. The other thing about talking about carbon capture and sequestration, there is a type of fuel cell called molten carbonate fuel cell. So you have PEMs, you have solid oxide fuel cells, you have molten carbonate. In the molten carbonate, you actually operate with CO2, with carbon monoxide and CO2. So those molten carbonate fuel cells could use CO2 from a power plant to produce electricity, and that would be a fairly effective way to capture and hopefully then sequester the CO2 in another way. So fuel cells, it's a great technology. There's a lot of work going on around the world with fuel cells, and I think they offer a great opportunity. Let's talk about batteries. We are not going to spend a lot of time this week talking about batteries, but in the US, there is a major effort to electrify transportation. And we talk about batteries here a minute ago with Tesla. And there are five things that we investigate with batteries. The first one is safety. And I don't know if you have seen those videos. There are some videos in YouTube where laptops explode. I don't know if you have seen those. There are a few cases where laptops have exploded because the lithium-ion batteries get overcharged. They get overheated, and then they explode. So that's a big issue. So the last thing that you want to see if you are an executive in General Motors or an executive in Tesla, the last thing you want to see is a car exploding, because that could really kill the technology. And in fact, there was a big accident in the US with a Tesla. It was driving on the highway, and there was a piece of metal that somehow got embedded into the battery, and it caused a short, and the battery exploded. Big problem. And as a result of that, they have now a titanium plate underneath the battery to prevent this from happening again. So the first thing that we investigate is safety. Okay. Now, in a battery, you are putting a lot of energy stored, so the potential for something happening is there. Okay? You are putting a lot of energy in a concentrated way. There's a possibility that it could be released very rapidly. In a battery, what you have two electrodes, you have an anode and a cathode, and then you have a separator. The separator in most lithium-ion batteries is a polymeric material, okay? So if I remove the battery from my laptop, or if I show you a battery in a, this is the bolt, this is the GM bolt, what you have is this multi-layered structure where you have a current collector, which is copper, and you have the anode, which is usually graphite, then you have your separator, which is a polymer. And you have a cathode, which is an oxide of lithium, and then you have a layer of aluminum, which is your current collector on the cathode. And then you have a lot of surface area. The more surface area, the more current that you can generate. And each battery produces about 4.4 volts. Okay? If for some reason your polymeric material gets ruptured, the anode and the cathode are going to come into contact. You have a short. That short generates heat. That heat melts the polymer. More area of the anode becomes in contact with the cathode, more heat gets generated, and then all of a sudden you have this snowball reaction, and then the separator gets completely melted, and then you have a big explosion in the battery. Okay? So this is the big concern with lithium-ion batteries, that you cannot afford to have a short between the electrodes. And this is where ceramics come into the picture. We are actually developing separators that contain ceramic materials to prevent internal shorts in lithium-ion batteries. The first topic when it comes to batteries is safety. What can we do either by using structural materials or some engineering to prevent internal shorts that may lead to an explosion? Okay? The second aspect that we investigate is energy density. And energy density is how much energy can you store in your battery. This translates into how many miles can you drive in your car. So if you look at the Prius, which uses a nickel metal hydride battery, you can probably drive about 10 miles with the Prius batteries. It's not a very long distance. Lithium ion gives you up to 40 or 50 miles per charge. And hopefully we are trying to develop batteries that will give you 300 miles per charge. That's the holy grail, 300 miles per charge. And we are not there yet, but we know what the direction is. So the first objective is safety. Second objective, energy density. How much energy can you store in your battery? The third one is power density. How fast can you charge your battery? Or how fast can the battery be discharged, give you acceleration? Okay? So safety, energy density, power density. The fourth one is durability. How many cycles can you put in your battery? Because remember, you drive during the day, you discharge the batteries, and gotta recharge them. And if you do that every day, you know, in a year you have 300 cycles, 10 years you have 3,000 cycles, And if you remember from your fatigue studies, you know, the more number of cycles, the more the damage. So durability is a very important aspect in lithium-ion batteries. How many times can you put charge and discharge? In the case of lithium-ion batteries, what you do is you take the ions of lithium, and they go from the anode to the cathode, and they get intercalated into the crystalline lattice of the material. And then you discharge your battery, the ions go in the opposite direction. So the ions of lithium are going back and forth. And from a thermodynamics point of view, you have some changes in the microstructure. And then those changes become larger, and then at one point you start losing the ability to store energy, and the batteries die. And that's what happened with your cell phones. You know, after 2 or 3 years, your cell phones cannot charge that much energy anymore. So that's what we call durability, okay? And there's really nothing we can do about it. In thermodynamics, you are always going to generate some entropy, okay? And entropy gets translated here into changes in the microstructure of the material. So you have non-reversible changes that will make the material become no longer able to give you what it used to give you when it was new, okay? So safety, energy density, power density, durability, and the fifth one is cost, okay? Cost. And people are not going to buy a $50,000 car, okay? And the biggest expense in these cars are the batteries. So what can we do to reduce the cost of the batteries? Well, we can start looking for low-cost materials. You know, most of these materials depend on cobalt, which is not cheap. So there are new technologies based on manganese. Some technologies depend on nickel. The price of nickel has gone up, so the price of the batteries goes up. So being able to utilize abundant, low-cost materials is one of the biggest challenges. So safety, energy density, power density, durability, and cost. Those are the big 5 objectives when it comes to battery research. And there is a lot of work going on, and that's really at the heart of these batteries. Let me show you this picture. You guys recognize that picture? Anywhere? It's out of this planet. That's a clue. It's out of this planet. It's Mars, okay? This is the Mars Science Lab. This is Curiosity, the rover, okay? This has been going on, it's been running around Mars for the last 3 years. What you have here is the power supply, okay? And we're going to talk about this on Thursday, but I'm just going to give a quick glimpse. This power supply generates 220, 230 watts, okay? Remember the 100 watt light bulb analogy that we're talking about? This is 220 watts. So it doesn't look like much. I mean, if you think about it, you know, we used to have 100 watt light bulbs produce light. This one generates 220 watts. So that would be enough power to keep 2 light bulbs, 200 watt light bulbs running on a continuous basis, which probably doesn't seem like much. But this is enough energy to move. It has a number of electric motors, and this is a motorized device that moves back and forth. It has a laser spectrometer to do chemical analysis. It has a laser to drill on the ground and pick up samples. It has like 5 different spectrometers to identify compounds. I mean, I suspect that there are more scientific instruments in this device than some universities in the world. I mean, this is just a remarkable instrument. And it's been moving very reliably. So this was one of the first pictures that came from this mission. And we're going to talk about thermoelectrics on Thursday, and I have a video. It's a video made by NASA that shows the landing. Have you guys seen the landing of this on Mars? Okay, you have to see it. As engineers, I mean, this is as good as it gets. But this was one of the first pictures that we got, and this picture was received by a group in the West Coast. It's called Teledyne. This is a company that put together this power supply. It was a collaboration between Boeing and Teledyne. And we got involved in that project. At the Oak Ridge National Lab, we had about 4 or 5 different activities that went into this system. The first one was to encapsulate the fuel. Remember, this relies on plutonium. There's an isotope of plutonium called plutonium-238. that generates a lot of heat. Okay. So what we did at the lab was to put that plutonium inside a capsule of iridium. Iridium is the most expensive material on Earth. It's a refractory alloy. Okay. And it's very difficult to manufacture, and we have some special techniques at the lab where we make these capsules, and inside those capsules you have the plutonium. The other thing that we did at the lab is we look at the thermal insulation, and we use a porous material that it's actually used not just for thermal insulation, but it's also used as a structural material. It's used as a spring to keep this system under compression. Okay. And we'll talk about that on Thursday. So this was one of the first pictures. And as soon as the rover landed, they started getting pictures of different components to make sure that they had landed without any damage. And as soon as the guys at Teledyne got this picture, they sent that to us, because we have been involved in this project. So this is one of the more exciting projects. But the reason I'm showing you this project is that it relies on thermoelectric materials. These are materials that can take heat and convert it into electricity, okay? And we're going to talk about this in detail on Thursday, but the implications of this should be important, because if you remember these energy flow diagrams that we talk about, 60% of the energy is wasted. Most of the energy is wasted as heat. Imagine if we had a technology that could convert heat into electricity. So take, for example, an internal combustion engine. 30% of the engine, the energy in the fuel, gets wasted as heat. Remember that diagram that I showed you? So what if we had a technology that could take that heat and convert it into electricity? And this is a project that we had with General Motors, where using this thermoelectric material, we could take the heat from the exhaust of the engine and convert it into electricity. And if you do that, you can replace the alternator in your car. All the electricity that you will need in your car will be produced by taking the heat from the exhaust of the engine. And by doing that, you could improve fuel efficiency by 10 to 20%. So this is an example of how we have used material science to convert waste heat into electricity. Imagine if we could use those materials in every furnace that we have on Earth. I mean, if you go to a foundry to produce metal, you have all these furnaces, and there is so much heat that gets wasted. Imagine if we could capture all of that heat and convert it into electricity. And that's what material science can do. So this is an example. We're going to talk about this on Thursday. This is an example of this, this system to recover waste heat and produce electricity. The other technology that we'll discuss on Thursday is that we could use these materials for air conditioning inside an automobile. If you think about the thermoelectric, have you seen a thermocouple to measure temperature? Okay, the thermocouple is an example of a thermoelectric material. You take two dissimilar materials and you bring them together into a junction. And if you apply a temperature gradient across the junction, you produce a voltage. Okay, and the more thermocouples you put, the more current you can get. That's exactly how these things work. Now, the thermocouples that we have probably used in the laboratory are type S thermocouples, platinum, platinum, rhodium, type K, type R. Here we are using fancier materials like lead telluride, bismuth telluride, to produce electricity from heat. So this is a remarkable technology, and this is really something that could revolutionize. If we could develop this with low cost, abundant material, we could recover a lot of the wasted heat in industrial processes or in everyday life. Okay? So if you ask me to make a prediction, I tell you that if we could have a breakthrough here, we could really change the course of history. And this is where material science is.